We're going to go ahead and get things started.
We can only get so many trumpet players on the stage at the same time.
I know this is a panel that you've all been waiting for. So we'll put things together kind of in pieces here. Al Porcino, after his concert, went up to change clothes, so he's going to be down in just a minute, but we don't want to make you wait too much longer. So I want to introduce, now we called him the moderator, but again, he's really a part of this panel. But I figured he was the only guy that could keep things somehow under control on the stage. He always says that I get it, you know, I'm always getting him into these things, you know. Call him up, hey Bobby, we want to do a Bud Brisbois concert, or we want to do a Dizzy Gillespie concert, or the Miles Davis Gil Evans thing. So I guess I do get him into a lot of stuff, but he's sure a wonderful guy to enthusiastically make all these things happen, and he does a lot of the behind the scenes stuff. His biggest challenge yet, and I'm going to let him get to it. Here's Bobby Shue.
One thing I can tell you for sure, I don't do anything I don't want to do. That's for sure. And when Ken asked me to moderate his panel, I haven't experienced stage fright or fear or anything like that in years. It's been pretty cool. He asked me to do this, I've been trembling for months. I kept thinking, I tried to catch him in the hallway and say, what do you want me to do? What am I supposed to do? How am I going to keep these guys under control? I just want a pathway if I have to run out. But I thought about it a little bit, and it goes without saying that the respect and love I have for these guys to be up here, you know, is immense, you know. And it's quite humbling and almost overwhelming to still, after all these years, to be in the company of people like Al and Maynard. And unfortunately, Buddy Childers, who was scheduled to be here, is very ill and couldn't be here. And that's a really sad thing because... In my estimation, there are, you know, being a lead trumpet player, you hear Al talking about it at all times on stage. But the thing about, I would say this about being a lead trumpet player, it's a lot of people, there are a lot of different kinds of lead trumpet players. Some of them are just, some of them can only hit high notes. And some of them can't hit very high notes, but they can swing the hell out of the band, you know. And for my estimation, the thing about a lead trumpet player is the musicality that they have. They project a sound and a feel that sort of gives the identity of the band, you know. And they have to also be, they have to serve the writer. They have to be able to be flexible enough to do what the writer wants to hear and so forth. You know? But for my students, I've been teaching... We're trying to teach for a lot of years now, and the most important student in the world is me, to myself, because I have to teach myself how to play this doggone trumpet and then keep up on it every day. But I've been certainly influenced by certain lead trumpet players, and the first time I heard Maynard Ferguson play lead, I mean, he gets the reputation for just being high note trumpet player, but if you go back and check this guy's career out, he's an incredible jazz soloist. And all you can hear albums where he's on albums with Dinah Washington and Clifford Brown, and he's holding his own right in there with all the heavies, you know. So he's a great jazz player. And then when he plays power lead stuff over the band, he's an incredible lead trumpet player. So the high notes is an extra little thing that he does, you know. Then there's Al Porcino, you know, and very important lead trumpet player, and he. Especially like the Ken things, but the Terry Gibbs big band stuff that Al Porcino did is, I think, some of the best he's ever done. Stunning lead playing. And Buddy Childers, obviously, who was a very important lead trumpet player with back in the Ken days, back in the 40s. And there are a lot of great ones. I always tell my students, you got to listen to the best ones, you know. So I make them listen to those three guys. Plus, I would add to that Conrad Gazzo, who was great for all of the Nelson Riddle and Billy May stuff. I would also add to that the great Snooky Young, who came right out of the Lunsford band. and did the Basie stuff and has established, all of these guys have established what the rest of us try to do to play lead trumpet. So without them, we wouldn't know what to do, except we'd just bleed, that's all. So anyway, I'm, as I say, quite humbled to be in the company of these guys. And I didn't know how to do this, but I thought I would start things off with a bang. Here's Maynard Ferguson, please welcome. Questions at some point down the road, we're going to open it up for some queries and sorts. So,
well, for one thing, I'm most delighted to be here, and it's a lot of fun to see faces. It's funny that you guys aged and I didn't at all. Band leaders are the best liars, right, guys? We worked at it, you know. Bobby, you look wonderful, Ben, and two of the world's greatest trumpet players are right up here. Now I tell you what, I'm just the screech guy. Remember that? They used to say that, you know. Yeah.
From Canada.
That from Canada. Very nice to be here.
Is he okay?
Nice to have you back.
Thank you. And we just got back off the road, and that means we go back on the road. Ed, what's my parole?
Yeah.
A week. Probably in a couple of hours.
Yeah, and it's one of the thrills of my career is just watching all the young guys in my own band and making sure they that they don't play better than me, because if they do, I'll fire them.
It's true.
I had a lot of fun with both of these guys, and not too many of those things I can talk about right now. Vegas, right?
Yeah. That's right.
Oh, boy. That's right. Anybody want to ask me a question? Are we going to do anything?
You can do anything you like, you know.
Anybody want to ask me a question, like, did I really like
There's
my first wife or something?
Is it true that you left the Montreal Conservatory of Music in disgrace?
Did you hear that question in the back of the room? They wanted, this guy asked if, is it true that Maynard left the Montreal Conservatory of Music in disgrace?
They were disgraceful, I'm sorry. Yeah. Forgot about that. Yeah. Actually, the Montreal Conservatory of Music, I don't think I ever went there. The Conservatoire de Musique de la Provence de Quebec to the city of Montréal, right? Any Canadians here? Okay. And I know, but Benny Baker was my teacher there. They used to fly him up once every 2 weeks, and then the principal trumpet from the Hall Symphony, and they both examined my classical trumpet playing and decided it was hopeless.
There's a famous story, you know, the Titan thing that was a great symphony written to feature Maynard called The Titans.
Bill Russo, but as soon as he got that gig, writing for the New York Philharmonic and Bernstein, now you have to say William, no Bill Russo, you know. Bill Russo was the jazz trombone player with Stan Kenton, but once you become a composer, you got to be very careful. Have you talked to him? I hope he hears this.
The story is they're rehearsing the piece, and it's this ridiculous high piece, and if I'm not mistaken, the story goes that Maynard makes his first entrance in this thing, and this, you know, and Bernstein stops, and he says, excuse me, Mr. Ferguson, this part is marked pianissimo. And Bill Vacchiano, I think it was the principal trumpet player, he says to Mr. Bernstein, he says, excuse me, Mr. Bernstein, that is his pianissimo.
That's a true story. It's interesting, the trumpet playing, that every symphony orchestra, it's different according to the conductor, you know, because the Philadelphia Orchestra, I think Eugene Ormandy going way back, forte in that orchestra was forte, you know, but Bernstein liked everything kind of quiet, you know. I think he liked to hear the violinists. You know, I had no interest in that. They usually get in the way, don't they?
They do. In every way possible. I don't think 12-8 existed until violinists were around.
Well, yeah.
We had to write in 12-8 to teach them to play da, 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 da.
Oh,
da,
yeah. Da. Count those ledger lines. Yeah, and they would do things. musicians like mezzo forte, pianissimo, and things like that. And then I found out half of them were just showing a sense of humor. You know? They knew they weren't going to get it. Say that. Actually, both men that are up here with me, I can't afford them anymore, but I wish they were with my band right now because they're two very marvelous trumpet players and great friends. Anybody want to ask me a question that legally I can answer?
Maynard, before Kenton, I think you spent some time with Boyd Rayburn. Could you talk a little about that, please?
And Jimmy Doug?
Yeah, that's right. The first band I came with when I came to the United States was Boyd Rayburn's band, which was a very avant-garde band, so to speak, for that time. And it was so hip, we very seldom worked. But nonetheless, it was a great experience, and talk about getting to know every musician in New York City, because personnel would be whoever Boyd could get. And as a result, I did play with some wonderful musicians on that band, which was that awful combination of so many guys sight-reading a very difficult book. Because the book was written by people like Johnny Richards and
Handy.
It was so many great writers, you know. And it was if we could just keep Boyd off that bass saxophone. Other than that, he was great. Yeah. And
Jimmy Dorsey.
Okay, Jimmy Dorsey, I loved. What a wonderful experience that was, because I was a big fan of Dixieland music, and I was really lousy at playing it myself. At least that's my own evaluation, and it's the truth. Something about the swing era into the bebop era and all that, but it was Jimmy Dorsey's band. You had he always had his little Dixieland band within the big band, and it was a joy to sit in the same section with Jack Teagarden's brother. I'm sorry I said it that way, but Charlie Teagarden was just a marvelous Dixieland trumpet player, you know. And I was a great, I was a big fan of his, actually, you know. And eventually I got so I could kind of play that way, but I was never the real thing, no.
I don't think you need to worry about it now.
Something about those minor nines and flat fives even, and was like, you know, what the hell's that kid doing, you know, and all that, yeah.
What about the famous solo that they banned?
Oh, yeah, well, that was All the Things You Are, of course.
All the Things You Are, beautiful song.
And that was written, the arrangement was written by Denny Farnon, a Canadian composer-arranger. And when I joined the Barnett Band, the Charlie Barnett Band, he was with Capitol Records then. And by the time the record came out, Charlie Barnett got a call from Jim Conklin, who was then the president of Capitol Records, to say, for God's sake, by then I was playing All the Things You Are as my featured tune with Stan Kenton's band during the first year I was with him. And the call came anyway to Stan, because by that time the Barnett Band had folded and Charlie was in retirement, and it was, for God's sake, God's sake, stand. Do not let that Ferguson kid play All the Things You Are. And take it out of the tour, you know. And that was, we were on that Innovations in Modern Music tour. And we had added strings to the arrangement and all that kind of stuff. And that was because there was, in those days, a $1 million lawsuit was big. Nowadays, you get that for a car accident or something, you know. But nonetheless, it was, a lot of people said that it certainly got me a lot of notoriety and publicity, you know, because they had to pull it out of the book and all threats of lawsuits and then the arguments against should there be such a thing. You can, it gets very into all those legal things that I couldn't care anything about because it meant that Shorty Rogers, Stan was such a great band leader, and he immediately put me with Shorty and said, come up with something, and Shorty Rogers came up with the thing that just had my name to it, and was called, from the Stan Kenton Presents album, and gosh, I think we wrote that and mostly in the back of Stan's Buick Roadmaster. That was kind of a necessity because they pulled all the things you are out of the thing so they could avoid a lawsuit. So I think I caused a lot of trouble to a lot of band leaders. I think that was that whole thing was a thrilling thing for me to come to the United States and Boyd Rayburn to Jimmy Dorsey, and I was kind of a fish out of water in that band, but enjoying like a band that played totally different from me, but it was a great experience, you know.
I don't know if the people know, you were a multi instrumentalist with your own band. I couldn't believe it. He's playing trumpet, he's playing French horn,
Yeah, the saxophones, and I would play oboe duets with my brother. However, my brother played the oboe a little better than me. Well, a lot better, okay. But I really enjoyed that, and just somehow I had mother and father that were, they were school teachers and principals originally, then my mother retired, and my father was a school principal, and he was the first one to say, now Canadians out there, don't get mad at me, but my father would say, how come we don't teach music in the schools like they do in the States? You know, the States, that's very Canadian. But he really meant it, and he was very strong on that. And for a guy who was, I loved my father very much, but he was without a doubt the world's lousiest banjo player. And that was his only instrument, and like I say, he was not very good at it, but he loved it. And my mother had the, she played piano and stuff like that. Bobby, have you ever heard me play piano?
Do we have one in the room?
No, I was just going to say, if you haven't, you're very fortunate. Yeah. Now, that was not my thing, you know.
I remember when I was on the band, on Maynard's band,
comic in the band, a comic and a singer, and you never knew who you were going to get. Well, we got stuck with Tommy Sands, who's the singer. Remember this? Tommy Sands, right? And that's Funicello and all that stuff, you know, man. There's the hippest bebop band in the world, and then Tommy Sands up there. And he's got two little go-go dancers on the wiggling, you know, the fringe and all that stuff. And he does a nightly Charlie Chaplin act with the bowler.
Yeah, that's
what
I remember.
And he does this thing every night. Well, one night, I don't know what we've got in your mind, but after Tommy did his little bit, he split. And he didn't even stick around and listen to anything else. Then we're sitting there, and Maynard comes out of the wings with the bowler on and the cane, and he's doing a whole Charlie Chaplin act. He's doing like a tap dancing and the whole thing. This guy is like a vaudeville show. This whole thing, one guy, you know, it's unbelievable.
Well, you know what's so funny about that is that a well-kept secret most of the time was that's how I started out as a vaudeville act in Montreal, Canada. And I would say, and now he's playing the trombone. Oh, now we'll hear him play the saxophone. Oh, hear him play it. And there would be a very looking, lovely lady in a short skirt that would come out. And I did everything from burlesque theaters as a musical act to that kind of thing. So that's where I became just such a vulgar show-off, you know. I was tailor-made to be a band leader, right?
Exactly.
Said that for years. What about the trumpet section? Was the Charlie Barnett's trumpet section?
Oh, that was me going to school, and I would have the feature number that I would do, but Ray Wetzel was such a marvelous lead trumpet player, John Howell was the relief lead trumpet player, and then there was the Three Sons. Do you remember that group? Yeah. Okay. Well, that was not the original. The original was Severinsen, Erickson, and Ferguson, and we were the three other trumpets, and we just loved to call ourselves. Yeah, we're the Three Sons. And And Doc Severinsen, of course, was such a great player on that band. And Rolf Erickson was from Sweden. And, of course, I was from Canada, so it was quite an international trumpet section there and a great one. And but the funny thing is that the rest of us, the Three Sons, would always be asked by their people that knew them, just like they'd ask me, they'd say, "Oh yeah, oh you were with Barnett. Oh, you played lead with Barnett." And they'll say no, and then say, "Oh, did Doc play lead? No, did Rolf play lead?" Rolf was very popular in his own country in Sweden, and then came over. He was the main jazz man there, and he came to the United States just like I came from Canada, and. But it was funny that Ray Wetzel, and by the way, he was, you know, these guys are nice guys, you know, and Ray Wetzel was a nice guy most of the time. That kind of lead player, do you know what I mean? That, as long as you played the parts real good, you were all right, but he, you know how he'd do it? He wouldn't yell or anything like that. The gate would be over, and there might be even certain, especially in ballrooms, interpersonal relationships that might be projected. No. He'd say, 15 minutes, guys, and the gate's over, and that meant you're going to have a sectional, a trumpet sectional, 15 minutes after, well, they're still packing up, you know, but that might go until he was... He was happy with it, you know. I think he's a little like that, too. Yeah, I forgot about that.
There's a question back there.
In as much as we're reaching back, can either of you talk about Earl Spencer?
There's a question about Earl Spencer.
Yeah. Big band.
It was an L.A. band, and a trumpet player that I respected this guy, and I loved him. And I was the high note king before he came to the States. And the guy I'm talking about was Al Killian.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Unbelievable. And he was with the Earl Spencer. And I have an LP of the Earl Spencer band, and I play it all the time to hear Al and bring back memories. But,
Well, that's great. My memory, of course, is of Al Killian, because the very first gig that I played in the United States legally. We're reading about those guys in the newspapers and television nowadays. You know, I think I was illegal for the first year, and I just would go across the border and play the trumpet. You know, I thought that was cool. You know, and apparently it isn't. You know. But it was too late. Yeah. But anyway, on Boyd Rayburn's band, the very first night that I played there, the sort of sweetheart guy that just said, "Yeah, come on," it was Al Killian, and he was featured with Boyd Rayburn's band at that time, and he had great chops and all that kind of stuff. Oh yeah.
That's a question about Irene Krall joining Wingard's band.
Yeah, sure. Irene Krall, of course, I just adored her, and my wife just took after her and took her to Sax and to Jax. JAX, that's a woman's store. And I have lots of daughters, and I still have most of my money. But anyway, my I have to tell the story as it really is, you know. And Irene's no longer with us, but I was auditioning girl singers, which is quite a pastime, by the way. And and so one of the girl singers turned to the lady that was like, because there was about five of them, and I didn't kind of like doing that. You know, you wanted, somehow it was, I don't know, not my thing, but on the other hand, I really wanted to have a girl singer with the band, you know, so. But was really my wife, and she put on that tweed suit of hers and looked very businesslike, and Irene Krall being nervous, and needless to say, she was the winner, but there was four other girls there, and they got up and sang, and I just had the rhythm section, you know, and wanted to hear what they did to do, and we have a mixed audience here. I'll have to clean this up just a little, just a little. But she said she had just heard the band, you know, and of course she was the sister of Roy Krall, great singer, pianist, and so she turned around to this unknown woman that seemed to be running the auditions and said, "I'm going to get this gig if I have to go to bed with him." I didn't realize she was talking to my wife. Of course. Funny thing is, she got the gig. My wife had a good sense of humor. Yes,
I have a question. Some years ago, I went to see the Red Rodney Ira Sullivan.
Oh.
And do you know about Ira Sullivan, or any of you? Because he plays both the Reeves and the...
oh, yes. Yeah. Marvelous talent. Yeah. Okay, all right, no, because no, that was a guy of which I'd heard more. I think he wasn't around an awful lot longer as far as being predominant and being able to see him. Remember, I was, what was I, about 22 when I first came to the United States or something like that, and then I went right into a road band. So sometimes we don't get to stay in the jazz meccas of the world when we're doing one-nighters with a jazz band, you know, or a dance band like Jimmy Dorsey, where we played some very small towns and some very big cities. And, yeah.
There's a question over there.
Have Mayor discussed organizing his first band earlier years, and how you attracted talent to that band that you did?
Okay, the question, I guess, was really about talking about how I would put a band together in the early years and things like that. It always starts, you know, with, you know somebody, you heard somebody, and then all of a sudden, I think Willie Mayton was my number one guy for... because he was a writer and I was not, and I was a show off and he wasn't, and that meant I would get to be the leader, you know. And I'm losing that track of the question.
Performing your first big band.
Oh yeah, so. I went right from the big bands and the final band that I was with Canton, and as that folded, it wasn't too long before I was offered a yearly contract with Paramount Studios, and that was the age of the big epics like the Ten Commandments, 3 years in the making. And meanwhile, you were making all that money, and I learned how to drink. I was good at that. Oh yeah, yeah. Because you were on a quota system. You were not allowed to do other movies. The union was very strict on that. That they felt we were making too much money, which we probably were. And the point is, over the course of 3.5 years. Because I had a reputation, I was on time and a half, but instead of the hours that we were allowed to be called for, we averaged 3.5 hours a week. And sometimes it was all put in together, though there were times when I would, we're talking about like 6.5 weeks with no playing, and you also were not allowed to play, by the way, in ways that you'd like to, and they didn't even like you, they didn't like you go to, 47 guys are going to be mad at me, local 47, that is, and, if you went and sat in at a jam session, you got fined, you know, and for me, it was not trying to play for nothing. It was trying to remember where my chops were, you know, and all that kind of thing, because you knew sooner or later, when you did get your Paramount call, that they wanted you with your chops, you know. And when that orchestra fell to pieces in a strange sort of a way, that a lot of the members of that Paramount Orchestra, when it got to the point that they were doing the epics and none of the B pictures or any of the extra stuff, many of them went into businesses and stuff like that. But that also opened up a lot of fun things, because the lead trombone player had no chops left at all because he wasn't playing, wasn't allowed to play, and all that. So he just called Frank Rossellino, and he'd call in sick and say, and make sure you send it in. So you never knew at Paramount who was going to sit next to you, you know. And yet it worked out good because that's kind of the way the movie industry is now, actually, huh? Okay.
Is that when you were Tiger Brown?
Sorry, what?
Tiger Brown.
Tiger Brown? What's that? What's your question?
Didn't they ever call you Tiger Brown when you were recording?
Yeah, that was because I was under contract to another label, and Tiger was the name of my chihuahua, and Brown was the name of my first wife. Yeah.
Jerry Rogers was Roger Short.
What?
Jerry Rogers was Roger Short.
Oh, yeah, but he had some... Yeah, that's his real name.
Milton Rajinsky.
Yes.
Question over here, please.
Okay.
Bobby?
Jeff.
It's me, Dennis.
Oh, hi, Dennis.
Listen, we were in here yesterday talking about Robert Redinger and here's two trumpet players. I played with him in high school. And I remember Stan talking about the story and you also telling the story many, many times.
Okay, so we're talking about
a trumpet, and you know what you need. The band had to be held up.
Robert Redinger.
Oh yeah, Bob Redinger. Bob Redinger was a genius type of he really was unique because he was a great orchestrator and a wonderful but very far out composer. And he wrote The City of Glass for Canton, and then he wrote This Modern World, of which one of the things was called a trumpet. And so many trumpet players thought that that title was like, you know, if you're playing the symphony, you have your B-flat trumpet, and at least you have a C trumpet, and an A, whatever, you know. And a lot of people would say a trumpet. Oh, okay. Where it isn't the title read in any way that you wanted it to, but it was really just, Redinger called it a trumpet. And Canton had a lot of faith in Bob Redinger, and rightfully so, but on the other hand, that was a unique experience because he said Ferguson, as Stan always called me by my family name, and he said, Ferguson, I'm sending this guy up, and he's going to sort of be with you for a couple of weeks. And the band was on in between tours, and Bob Redinger suddenly became my, you might say, roommate. Yeah, I was unmarried at the time, so the two of us, I had a nice little house, and he was very definitely different. He was like a praying mantis. You know, he'd always be there, and nothing weird sexually or anything like that. But boy, I tell you what, he was just a vibe. He'd wait for me to practice, and I never was an infamous, I practiced, but I wasn't very, I didn't have a thing about it. I didn't have a system. I didn't have a, you know,
routine.
No routine, thank you, yeah. And a pretty disorganized person, I guess. And and Grettinger didn't mind, but he would just wait for me to pick up my horn, and if I played anything, he'd sit there for a while, and then all of a sudden, he'd jump up and say, would you do, and you're just warming up, you're just playing, you know, and he'd say, just do that again, and he had a memory, because if I play a whole long phrase, just fooling around, we're not talking about out of the Arban book or out of the, any of those other funny books. but he would really be able to later write down every note that I had just played, and even though the ones that didn't sound too good, and he just had a photogenic memory. Well, how do you apply it to that? I don't know, but that was his the way he wrote a trumpet, and then he'd say, are you going to play some more? You know, he'd never say, well, would you try to play something on an A minor? He would purposely not direct me in any way, and then tell me that the thing was written, a trumpet, you know. And I looked at it, and I said, oh, it's a nice piece of writing, very difficult. and he said, no, that's what you always play. And you'll discover that I think we're all like that. You know, when we're fooling around with our horns and we're warming up or we're whatever, it's just something that we do that we've done for so often we don't think about it. It's like the saxophone player trying reeds, you know. He isn't really thinking about how great he's playing or anything like that. He wants to know with us getting our chops going or getting our air going or whatever, you know, or trying to be sober. Yes, sir.
Over there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I had a question for Al. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about your experience with Thad Jones.
There's a question about Al's experience with the Thad Jones Orchestra.
Oh, yeah.
Before I say anything, are you a Thad Jones fan?
Can we have a drum roll, please?
Maybe another different question.
Tell the truth.
Yeah, I worked with the band twice. It was 69. We went on a one-month tour of Europe. There is a very good video of us playing in the radio or recording studio in Copenhagen. I don't know if it's available here in the States, but it's quite good. Yeah, well, about that. A big talent, let me say that before you get the wrong impression that I didn't like the guy. Big talent, there's no question about it. I wish he had played more because he let all the other guys play and he was a good sword. His music was a little tough, you know. I mean, the saxophones could play it, but I couldn't play it, you know? I was never a technician, you know? And anyhow, he sort of became the new Duke Ellington, you know? And I have to be honest, it wasn't my cup of tea. And then I joined the band again in 76 when we went to Europe and played a month at the new club there, the Domicile, packed every night. You know what I don't like about some guys? When they get real big, they really take advantage of it. I mean, it's not being professional. Coming late, trying to explain a charge takes 5 or 10 minutes. significant, but I like to do things professionally. And he always had a heavyweight sax section, you know, Joe Henderson, Jerry Dodgen, Jerome Richardson, Eddie Daniels, Pepper Adams, and so forth. They could play the music, but I couldn't. There is a good video that I said we did in Copenhagen, and that's worth having. And, yeah. Well, then you talk about his co-leader, Mel Lewis. I mean, Mel Lewis, great drummer and all that, but he never said anything. He let Thad run the whole show. Why not? Thad made him world famous. And I just heard the band 2 weeks ago in New York, and the one thing I didn't like then, and I still don't like it, when I go to hear a band, I want to hear an ensemble in tutti. There you go in, the tenors playing chorus after chorus, trombones playing chorus after chorus, trumpets playing chorus, and you don't hear any ensemble. For me, big band means ensemble. I want to hear solos, I go hear a quintet. As I say, that was a big talent, but I have to be honest, I didn't enjoy working on the band. Simple as that.
Bobby?
Okay, yes.
Maynard, would you reminisce about Jimmy Ford for a few minutes?
Jimmy Ford, the alto player.
Oh, yeah. All right. First of all, one of the most favorite naughty boys to ever be on my band. I absolutely adored Jimmy Ford, and I liked him so much. And Willie Maiden, who was, aside from being the world's greatest and beer drinker, yeah, he was a wonderful, of course, arranger, saxophonist, and all that. But he just loved the way Jimmy Ford played the alto saxophone. And he auditioned for me, and as soon as we heard his solo playing, this is in Birdland, and it didn't take long for us to discover that he couldn't read a note. He literally could not read a note. And, you know, like the A, is that the one with the first two fingers? And Willie Maiden was that kind of a team player. He said, yeah, but what a soloist, you know. He said, if you'll hire him, I'll teach him. And Willie Maiden taught Jimmy Ford how to read music on the gig. Because it wasn't like he started a month later. He opened with us that night in Birdland. And boy, there was a lot of scuffling going on with guys. Luckily, I had four saxophones, and I had another cat who could cover a lot of the lead parts. But Jimmy had all the great sound and everything for it. Just had no music education whatsoever, just great ears and great record collections and things of that nature. And he had been fired off so many bands. I don't mind saying this because I was the last hope. And really amounted to that. And he just decided, okay, it's. It's this one, or you know, I'm out of here, you know, whatever. And but it was really Willie Maiden just loved the way he played his solos and stuff like that. And you know, there's no more dismal place than a 10 till 4 a.m. in the morning jazz club when you're in there at 10 o'clock in the morning, you know. And that's, he'd be teaching Jimmy Ford his parts, you know, because Jimmy was really just memorizing, you know. That Willie wouldn't have that. He was a good teacher. No, I want you, you know. And it was a very unique thing. I don't think I ever had that before or afterwards on my band where one guy in the same section would say, okay, I'll teach you, but on-the-job training, you know. And believe me, there were a lot of long notes going down, too, for a while, you know. Yeah.
Didn't you start your first band here in L.A. around 57, something like
You mean my first? Oh yeah, I had an experimental band because we had so much time off at Paramount, and then I decided, no, I want to start my own band. I was with, I think Mercury Records, and then eventually I got the Birdland contract with. What's the name of Birdland's record label? Roulette Records, and I believe Morris Levy was a Jesuit priest who. as I recall, but the memory's a little funny now, you know. but nonetheless, Morris Levy owned a lot of enterprises, including me. Yeah.
The question he owned me for a while, didn't he?
Yeah.
Mm. Real quick question, probably everybody else knows, but me. Lynn Nicholson, why such a short stint and why such a short stint in your band, and what were the circumstances?
The question about Lynn Nicholson.
Oh, yeah, well, he was just an extremely talented lead trumpet player. And the short tenure, I can't even, I did not fire him, first of all, so, and I wasn't very good at that, you know. Yeah.
Was there any compression between him and Stan Martin?
Okay. This guy must be writing for one of those rags or something like that. And actually, they had the same wife, and... Well, let's make them happy. Just a minute now.
Interestingly, Stan Mark now is a limo driver up in Oregon, and Lynn Nicholson lives in Las Vegas and has designed some sort of very high-tech camera stuff.
Oh.
And that's his business. He's making millions of bucks doing all these unbelievable camera things. You know, I'm looking for a real job myself.
Yeah.
You know, this trumpet stuff's got to go. Mike?
I'm standing here thinking of all the records that I've heard Al on, and for some reason, Buddy Rich did a record called Mercy Mercy that you were called in, as I read in the liner notes, to play lead, even though you really weren't on the band at that time.
I had joined about a week before we went into Jesus.
I'm not finished. The question really is, how did you get along? How did you get along with Buddy?
So. Just Mike's question is about Al's relationship with Buddy Rich and the Mercy Mercy album in Vegas.
Yeah, well, I knew Buddy from 1944 when he was with Tommy Dorsey out there in California. He had heard me with Louis Prima playing all these high notes. I guess he thought I was a jazz player. Anyhow, I was with Louis Prima in New York, Park Central Hotel. I get a telegram. Tommy Dorsey wants you to get on a plane. I get out here. They're in Paramount Studios making a picture. And I meet Tommy, okay, blah, blah, blah. And the first tune they want to record is Song of India. As you know, Bunny Berrigan made that fantastic solo. It's a classic. And they want me to play the solo. I mean, I wasn't a jazz player, anyhow. It was not a very pleasant few months I was on the band. But what else was in the
question? I'm just trying to picture knowing what we think we know about Buddy's personality, and I know, you know, certainly Bobby worked with it too. How you two got along?
He was the most difficult man in the world at that time because he was bigger than Tommy Dorsey. People came. We were doing a 15-minute Lucky Strike radio show. We were working on the film out there. We were playing at night at the Hollywood Cantinas in 1944 during the war. And, you know, he'd come to the studio in a sweatshirt with a towel, and we were in our uniforms, you know. And he has, you know, he had the biggest ego in the world, which is understandable. Nobody could play those paradiddles like he did and all that stuff. And that was my first experience with Buddy. And then, of course, when I joined him in 1968, I'd been here for 10 years. And then, long story, I left LA. playing the first week. Lean in. Saturday night, we finished the second show. Buddy says, wait a minute, fellas. Now you don't understand. I want you back here at 3 in the morning. We're going to record. And we start recording all those things, including this suite that was really tough. Channel 1 suite. Don Venza was on the band, and Art Pepper and I, and yeah, it was quite unique. People were just dropping in, hey, if you want to come in, hear the rehearsal, blah, blah, blah. That is quite a good album, actually, the Mercy Mercy album. Mercy Mercy was the title number. It was a rock thing that this trombone player at Berkeley wrote. What was his name?
Phil Wilson.
Yeah, another far out play, what can I say? I don't like far out plays.
Speaking of far out, we're out of time up here, and you have the next event starting in 15 minutes. How about a hand for Al Pacino? Maynard is going right now to the Tower Records booth and going to be signing his new CD, so...
There you are.